Thank you all for being here. I start on time, end on time. It is 2 o'clock, almost on the nose. So I'm Cree Taylor. I'm your moderator for the session today. And I'm so glad that all of you have tuned in to listen to Christopher Phillips talk to us more about accessibility and inclusive learning, creating inclusive and accessible learning communities in our classrooms. I've heard Christopher present before, and I just keep coming back because I learned so much from his presentations every single time. So I'm glad I get to moderate this session. Before turning the time over to him, I'll introduce him to all of you. So Christopher Phillips is the Campus Accessibility Coordinator for Utah State University. He is the Electronic and Information Technology Accessibility Coordinator. There's the whole title, where he works to integrate inclusive online experiences for everyone. He has worked as a product manager, special educator, instructional designer, web developer, and is excited to work with anyone in the campus community to help create usable, accessible, and welcoming environments for all students. And I have had a lot of interactions with Christopher Phillips during my brief time here, and it's always been positive, and I've always just learned a lot and incorporated a lot of what he's taught me. So I'm really excited for all of you to hear this presentation. So I will turn the time over to you. Chris, you got it.
Thank you so much, Cree. I appreciate that. My title is not very accessible, so congrats on making it through that. So happy to be with all of you today, and thank you for joining this session. We don't have a lot of time to go around and hear from everybody, but if you are willing to just share what department you're from in the chat there, I've got that open. Would love to get a sense of which departments you're from today. English there. Thank you. Perfect. I appreciate you sending those in. That's helpful background. Cree mentioned, I'm the campus EIT Accessibility Coordinator, and probably all of you are familiar with the Disability Resource Center on campus. My role is a little bit different, where the DRC supports students, or you may get letters from them or emails from them about specific accommodations. My role, I get to kind of just do proactive work as far as towards making our campus content and electronic experiences more accessible and inclusive. And we're gonna talk today just for a minute about something I like to call just the curb cut effect, or this idea or principle of curb cuts. You see curb cuts anywhere as you walk around campus, around town. Curb cuts did not used to exist. It used to just be road would come up against the sidewalk. And if you were a wheelchair user, for example, you would have to figure out a way to navigate that. But there along came some rules and regulations that required curb cuts be put in place to make those sidewalks more accessible. There was a lot of complaining and kind of people who didn't feel like this was needed. It was for a very small population. However, as curb cuts kind of became more widespread, it turns out they're useful in a lot of different scenarios. And this is where I'll just ask for a second here. If any of you can think of a scenario, a time when you've used a curb cut, or maybe seen them be useful to someone in a certain context or time. And you can either throw those into the chat or jump on the mic, whatever's easier for you. When are curb cuts helpful? Strollers, perfect. Thank you, Lacey. Let's get one, riding my bike. I saw that, perfect. Good, stroller bike. You guys are on top of this. This is perfect. And so, anything with wheels, perfect. I love it. And so curb cuts are useful in so many different scenarios now. Somebody mentioned earlier a session on pushing a dolly or a lab cart around as well, or a toddler maybe stepping up onto a sidewalk. Or if any of us live long enough, we might eventually ourselves have a little bit difficulty kind of making that big of a step up and may benefit from curb cuts. But it's this idea that curb cuts, something built for accessibility, ends up being usable for everybody and just kind of making that experience better. So much so that even if they weren't needed or required, we would probably still continue to build curb cuts in our sidewalks. And today we're going to talk about just a few kind of canvas curb cuts, things that some of them are going to be just kind of useful for all students, some of them that are accessibility focused, but again, would apply to everybody. So, and especially this semester, as we're still in a little bit of a topsy-turvy situation with hoping that we'll be able to be in class a lot more, but knowing that we're doing online classes and that we can't really count on our students to be sitting in front of a desktop computer all of the time. And they may be accessing your content on a laptop, a tablet, and they may be accessing it from all different kinds of, you know, locations as well on their mobile devices, trying to catch up and keep just keep up with their schoolwork any way they can. And so while I use kind of accessibility and usability interchangeably, really the idea here is we're thinking about just how do we create course experiences and provide our content in a way that's going to be inclusive, usable, helpful, accessible, and welcoming to as many students as possible. And there's a couple things I'm going to jump in and out of Canvas here. Just we'll do some demos. If you have a Canvas course that you're working on and kind of finishing up for fall semester, you can even open up and do some of this stuff right along with me. Some of it's just quick and dirty stuff that we can do that quick. And the first one I'm going to talk about is maybe one we wouldn't typically think about accessibility, but by far our largest group of students with disabilities on campus are those who have mental health challenges or might fit into the category like around anxiety, ADD, ADHD. And if they come into your course, and Canvas does this by default, unfortunately, but they'll throw in a lot of extra menus that you don't use generally as a teacher. You may not even know what they mean, and they're just there. And so a student comes into your course and they have to navigate through all of these, you know, 10 or 20 menu options to find the content that you're actually using in your course. But it's super easy to get rid of these. And this is where I'm just gonna jump over to Canvas to look at this. And any of you can do this right along with me. To update your menu options, it's super quick and easy. All you do is click on your course settings on the bottom of that left navigation there. And before I do that, and most of you probably are already familiar with this trick, but the one thing we generally recommend people to do before you teach a course, anytime you teach a course, is to use this right up here. There's a student view. Again, this is probably something you're familiar with already, but it doesn't ever hurt to just do a quick check on the student view and to kind of see your course as your students see it, because it's a different experience that your students have than what you have as a teacher. And that's just one quick thing. And again, as a student, you can see, holy cow, there's a lot of menu items over here. That might be a little bit overwhelming. But then again, we're going to come back here to the course settings, and then it's going to be the third tab over. There's course details, sections, and we're going to click on navigation. And this is where you've got this great big long list of all these menu items that are in your course. And you get to go through these and get rid of anything and everything that you don't feel like is helpful to your students. And even things like one of them that is often enabled is the files module. I actually have it turned off here. But if you're linking to your files from course pages or from course modules, you don't need to make the files area available, for example. And you also don't have to worry about students seeing all your kind of unorganized files. But so if you're in here, all you need to do is kind of look at it, and like chat and collaborations is one that kind of is on by default. I can just click on that and turn those off one at a time. And again, you can really think through what do students need to see. For example, your Canvas pages. If you use pages for your students to navigate, great. But if you link to all of your pages in modules, and you can go ahead and zap it out of here. Again, it's just simplifying that experience, whatever we can do to make a better experience for your students. And again, if you're using discussions, keep them there, of course, right? Make sure you're keeping the things that you are using, but you're welcome to also get rid of anything that you're not using. You can also in here move things up and down. Maybe you want your syllabus to be at the top. Maybe that'll get one more student to read it, who knows. You can do some of that. Then as soon as you're done, just come down here and click on save. And then as soon as that saves, there we go. Then again, I can, after I do that, go into that student view again. And this time it should be a much kind of cleaner experience for them over here. I can see that's a much more manageable set of links, right? And that's going to be easier for students to come in here and see the content that's important to you. That's just a quick little thing that you can do to get rid of those And again, there are some, as Karen kind of points out, sometimes there's things that don't show up unless they're being used, but some of them do show up kind of regardless of whether you're using them or not. And so my recommendation would be just to get rid of anything you're not using. But you can always see what's being used or not right there in that, right there from that student view. The next one is one, again, that we really recommend everybody do before you start the semester. Super easy, again, on this one, let me leave my student view. And some of you may be surprised. If any of you are feeling brave and vulnerable, you can run this right while we're doing it and share how many broken links are in your course. But it's not unusual for us to see upwards of 100 broken links in courses sometimes, especially if you've taught for a number of years. But what you do to see this is, again, in your left-hand menu, you're going to come over here to settings, and there's a link right here that says validate links in content. And if you haven't run this before, it'll make you run through it. But this is going to give you a list. Thank you, Dr. Stuntz. That's a helpful, Tracy, that you want to make sure to not reset your course content. Yikes. We'll all learn from your mistake there, perhaps. But as you're looking at these links, now this is great because it not only tells you which links to external resources are broken, but it'll also tell you if you're linking to content that's been deleted, or if you're linking to content that hasn't been published or from another course, so and again, you can go through and fix these one time and save your students from having to deal with that frustration over and over again throughout the course. And this is something where City can also be a resource. If you need help updating any of these links, please reach out to us. But the way this works right here, it'll tell you the content item, where that link is. And then right here, it'll tell you what that broken link is. So I can click on that announcement number 2. And then I can see right here, there's a link to a PDF. I can click on it. Sure enough, it says nothing's not found. Now you might think your students would reach out to you and tell you when they come across a broken link. But much of the time, that's just going to be kind of a free pass. I don't have to care about that assignment. And so I know that link is broken. I can come in here and edit that announcement or page or whatever it is and make that link work. And then as soon as I've done that, I come in here and I restart the link validation so you can get that number down as low as you can. Wonderful. How about that, Sean? You just fixed 3 broken links. I love it. That's what we like to see. Now, occasionally, it may tell you a link is broken and it really isn't. So you can always test them first, but it does a pretty good job usually as far as giving you an idea of what links are working or not in your course. So, and then the next thing I want to share, this is a tool that was actually developed here at Utah State that I use just about every day as we kind of work with courses in here. But to add this tool, we're going to do the exact opposite of what I told you a minute ago as far as removing items from navigation. You're going to come in here to settings, navigation, and you're going to look for a tool called Tidy Up. It'll be somewhere in this bottom area down here. So you'll just want to click and enable it or drag it up to the top and then click save. And then you're going to have a link right here to Tidy Up in your navigation. The other trick or tip for most of the tools like this, you can also just add I'll put it in the chat right there. It's a little shortcut to get there. If you just put that at the end of any of your course URLs, you'll go to Tidy Up for that course. And then I'm going to go ahead and just click on Scan Course. Now, depending on how much content you have in the course, it may take a couple of minutes to run. And so I have one over here where I've already run this. And I just want to walk through a little bit what's going on here. This is just gives you a fantastic kind of overview of the files and content in your course. Now, if you've taught for more than one semester, you likely have a number of unused files in your course. Canvas makes it super easy to add content, not always as easy to know what content could be deleted or is not in use anymore. So that's why we built Tidy Up. And as you look here in Tidy Up, and hopefully some of you are able to look at this in your own course, you'll see a list of files. Now I can come in here, I can hover over a file and see a preview, get a little bit of information about where that file is, etc. But then over here is the really useful information where I can see where that file is used. This could be especially helpful if there's an assignment. Maybe you link to it from multiple places in your course, right? But you can't remember everywhere. You can come in here real quick and check and see. But then the bigger thing here that's going to be super helpful is there's a filter here where you can come in here and see unused files. And this is basically telling me, here are all the files that are in your Canvas course files, but there is nowhere that you're linking to these. Maybe you look at one of these files, you can click on one of them and open it up in a new tab if you want to preview it and say, oh, I should be linking to that one, but I'm not. But often they're just files you used a previous semester and just they're not in use anymore. And so it's super easy in here. Either one at a time, you can go through and zap these out of your course. Or if you're comfortable and confident, you can just come in here, select all of those. If you want to download them first, you can, but then just click delete and it'll zap out all of those unused files out of your course. So you don't ever have to see them in your files list. Your students don't have to deal with them. It's just going to lead to a much cleaner and easier course experience. And then you can focus on the content you are using as far as making sure that it's usable and accessible. This is something we're also happy to do for you. If you just send us a course URL and say, please clean this up, we can go through and take care of this for you as well. But across all of our Utah State courses, I think less than half of the files are in use. And so there's likely, unless you do a really good job each semester of kind of doing this on your own, going to be some of these unused files in your course. And then the other tab I'll show you just real quick here. Similarly for files, this shows all of your Canvas content, your pages, assignments, quizzes. I can filter here. I can do a quick search if I want to. And then like based on this, I can look and see, is this file page published or not? That'll help you avoid those beginning of the semester complaints from students. It'll tell you if a page is in modules or not. Also, if there's any content in it or not. And then you can use the search here if you want. And then you can rename things really quickly and easily, kind of in this one place. Or in this case, what we have here is that there's a bunch of these pages that were duplicated in the course. Maybe you've seen that where you have two versions of everything. All of these have a -2 on them. So I can do a quick search for that. And again, I can just zap all of those pages out of my course instead of having to do it one at a time. And so that's a handy little Swiss Army knife to help you just get a good sense of what the content is in your course. Those are just three kind of quick tools that'll help you. We'll just zip through these slides. We kind of looked at those in person, get a little bit better handle on the content in your course and make sure what's available to students and in your course is what you actually want them to see. Now, a couple of accessibility kind of more focused tips or tricks. The first one I want to share real quick is the idea of just captioning your course videos. We've seen a huge increase in video across Canvas courses in the last year for a number of obvious reasons, I guess. But captions are one of those things initially really were talked about more as something that we would do for students who are deaf or hard of hearing. But like curb cuts, captions end up being helpful in a number of scenarios. And maybe I'll pause real quick here just for a minute to any ideas that you might have to share on why or when captions might be helpful, aside from someone who is deaf or hard of hearing. Good. You're somewhere where you can't turn on your volume. Maybe you're on campus and forgot your earbuds, for example, and you have it shared off as perfect. Yeah, some of you might be watching who knows what on a second screen as well, and you're with captions on while you're watching this even.
There was also mentioned in the chat of English language learners being able to hear and follow along as they read what's going on in the videos. That was mentioned in the chat as well.
Yep, I missed that. Thank you so much. That's actually one of the largest and kind of increasing needs where if you as an instructor, I have been told at times that my Idaho accent is difficult to understand. Perhaps students might have a difficult time understanding you, or just again, if you have any students who are English language learners, it's fantastic, as was mentioned there, to have captions on. It's so much easier to read a language for most people before you can hear it and understand as well. So that's a great reason as well. And then we also are kind of seeing there's an increasing just body of research that just captions if a student is both listening and watching to something, it's just going to be a little bit more effective as far as getting that into their noggins and helping them to learn. And so lots of good reasons for captions. Another tool we're really excited about that's kind of available in a beta or pilot if anybody wants to try it. But if you have videos that are captioned, there's this video player that we can use in Canvas where it'll show the transcript on the right. A student can download the transcript to read, or they can do a search right there in the transcript. It'll see, they can, for when did you talk about decimal positions? If they click on that, it'll go boom right to that section of the video. They don't have to scrub around to find the exact place in the video where you talked about something. And we're really fortunate here at Utah State to have some captioning resources available to you. So if you have videos, if you're using video in one of your courses, please just reach out to this email, captions@usu.edu. And as our criteria right now is that, are you going to use these videos over multiple semesters? But as long as you're planning on using a video for at least two semesters, we're happy to go in and caption your videos for you. And would love to hear from you. Again, open up that email and shoot that off. Let us know so we can do that for you. We would be happy to. And then if the DRC does contact you at some point about a student that needs captions, you can just say we're already set. And then every other student in your class that prefers captions on videos, they have them there and can use them at any point. So a couple other things I'll go through just real quickly here. This is just a small little hack, but as human beings, one of the way we visually scan the web is by using links or headings. And so we look for links to kind of give us a sense or an idea of where am I going next. But if you're using links that are like this, click here, read more information, those are super not helpful. And that problem is even compounded for someone who is blind or low vision because of the technology they use to access the web. And so instead of doing a click here, just do a short little descriptive of what your link is. Nothing long, but just if you can say something like submit assignment, review instructions, that's super important for accessibility. But again, it's also just going to help all of your students kind of get to where they want to go quicker. This one I want to show off real quick again in Canvas. This is something that's already available in all of your Canvas courses. Let me just go to a page where I have this. Anytime you link to a document, whether that's a Word document, a PDF document, a PowerPoint, you'll see a little arrow next to that file. Now your students see this arrow, they don't see this one right here. That's a separate workshop. In fact, it's if you're interested more in accessibility of your documents, we're doing one of those on Friday. I'll put the notes in Mighty Networks if you're interested in that. But today I just wanna show you this little cool feature where a student can click on this and they click on alternative formats. And they can download that PDF file or Word document in any of these formats. Including an audio file. And so that means a student can take your PDF document, download it as an audio file and listen to it on their way to school or when they're out weeding their garden, whatever it might be. Super useful. And it's been there for a little bit and some students know about it. It's getting quite a bit of use already, but we'd love to, it may be something you just mentioned to your students to, again, these formats are important for accessibility, but most of the students who use them are just using them because they prefer these formats better than the alternative. So D-Line Reader is another one that just helps students, it kind of colors the text. You can go in and try this on some of your own files to give that a try. So anyways, that's a little tool that's built right into Canvas that all of your students can use. You don't even have to do anything. It's just right there available to them. There's an example. I'm going to skip through a couple of slides here. We're going to go fast to this next section. I will just mention maybe, I guess, real quick, there is an accessibility report built into your course. Again, you can find that from your navigation settings. You can get an accessibility score of your course and then look at what you need to do to make it more accessible. But if you do this or are interested in this, again, there's a separate workshop or please reach out to us. We would love to work with you in making your content kind of more technically accessible in getting rid of some of those red meters you see around. Okay, The next thing I want to talk about real quick is this idea of oftentimes, in fact, for most of our courses at Utah State, we have teachers who often do an incredible job making Shireen, I'll make sure to include that. I'll jump out in a second and show you that accessibility, where you can see that in a course. In fact, let me just real quick, I'll do that. Thank you. So anywhere you link to a file, you'll see this little arrow next to it. Or if you go into your files section, then there's these three dots over here on the right. You can click on those three dots and that alternative formats is available right there as well. For the accessibility report that I mentioned, I'll just show you real quick because we don't have a lot of time. But there is, it's just, it's one of these menu options again, so you can turn that on and then it'll be available in your course and you can take a quick peek at it here. And if you're new to that, it even has a little section here with content with easiest issues to fix. So that's just right there in your course you can take a look at. Okay, but so this issue, the nature of it is that we have these courses and you put your all this blood, sweat, and tears into it. And then usually what we see, and again, this is, I don't want anybody to feel guilty because it's something that all of us do in academia. It's by far the most common type of content is PDF. And so I kind of, the verb I've come up with is that they PDF that course. And so a student is clicking along in the navigation through the modules and they click on a PDF link and who knows what happens. It may download to their computer. It might open up in a new window. It may preview right in there. But these PDF files that are so common that we all rely on can be really problematic for accessibility, but also just for usability in general. And so one of the things we say is we used to kind of recommend people convert their PowerPoint or Word documents to PDF, and that's just no longer the case. If you have something in PDF or Word, just post it as a PDF or Word file. But then we also have a lot of files that look like this maybe. You've got, you know, maybe you're gonna get to the left or the right. And a lot of students, again, they can pretty quickly maybe turn this document right side up and get through it. But for some students, that's going to be a little bit of a challenge, right? Maybe turning their laptop upside down or here's a PDF document that was just a real poor scan. Ironically, this one is called Designing Challenging Curriculum, or perhaps not ironically, I guess they kind of nailed it. Just PDF files can be difficult to read. And even if you have a nice clean PDF file such as this, you get from the library, if a student opens that up on their mobile device, they're going to have this micro text they have to get a magnifying glass for, or they're going to be doing this experience where they're having to go back and forth and back and forth to be able to read that content. PDF files, I mean, there's a reason that if you go to Amazon, for example, you're not going to see a lot of product descriptions as PDF files because they're just, it's just not a very usable format. And this is the exciting part. We finally have something to kind of, we can kind of do about that. And so we've developed an incredible process here using some technology, and we have some incredible student workers where we can take the PDF files in your course, something that looks like this, and with a couple of clicks, turn it into a nice, beautiful, clean, accessible, mobile responsive Canvas page. The student can still click on the PDF and download it if they want, but we most of the time see that they just don't, there's no need for the PDF once they have this kind of experience. I'll show you just a couple more demos here. Here's a table, again, converted to a Canvas page, or here's another scanned PDF document. Once that's a Canvas page, you open that on your mobile device, and it's what's called responsive, so it'll adjust the screen and make a nice clean viewing experience for the student. And as I mentioned, there's actually a tool built into Canvas where you can do some of this yourself if you would like to. Let me just again do a quick show you what that looks like as we wrap up on time here. That if you go to files area, I'll just show you real quick, but the recommendation we usually give. So here's a PDF file of an article from the Salt Lake Tribune, I believe. My internet's a little bit slow for some reason. You'll have to trust me on that, I guess. It's not going to show up right off the bat here. A PDF file. But what you can do here, you click on these three dots, and one of the menu options right here is convert to Canvas page. If you click on that, it'll go extract all of the text out of the Canvas page, out of the PDF document, and create a Canvas page. Now, it's not going to be perfect. On this one, you can see some gobbledygook text at the top, so you'd have to go in and edit that. But again, our recommendation would be, if you just send that to us, we've done over 5,000 of these, and we've got just a fantastic process where we have every document's reviewed by a couple of people. Here's an example of one we just did, for example. Again, it's not a bad PDF document, but if I try to open this on a mobile device, it's just going to be a bad reading experience versus if I put that into Canvas, all of a sudden that's we add a nice reference at the top, format all the images nicely. And then if I open this on a mobile device, you've got a nice, clean, obviously just responsive, clean user experience. And literally, I mean, we're a little bit busy the next week or two, but we usually are. Please reach out to me as soon as you can on this if you're interested. We can get going on the documents in your course and help you get those ready before, well, maybe not before the semester at this point, but we can do this work as the semester goes as well. So our time is wrapping up here. In summary, though, I would just as we talk about usability or accessibility, a key thing to keep in mind, as I've just given you a bunch of stuff, is to not be overwhelmed by any of this. Sean, you know, we heard that you've already gone in and fixed a couple links, huzzah. And if that's all you're able to do as far as you're making your course more accessible, that's a huge win in my book. And you know, and pat yourself on the back going forward, you'll be in that much less frustration your students will have. And so even if there's just one thing you can do, reach out to us about doing your captions, let us help you with your files or anything around accessibility. And we would absolutely love to help you. And again, there is my follow-up information. I would really love to get some emails from some of you that we can help you or take a look at your course. We're happy to meet one-on-one if that's useful, whatever we can do to help make your course content more accessible and usable. Okay, that's it for my presentation. I am going to look at questions here in the chat, and we'll stick around for any and all questions that you have. So
yes, thank you, Christopher. Just to wrap up, everybody, that's the end of our session. It concluded at 2:30. The next session starts at 2:45, so you can navigate to the Mighty Networks website to click on the sessions you would like to attend there. And as Christopher just mentioned, if you do have questions and want to stick around, he will answer them for you in the chat. We'll probably leave it open for, what, 5 or so more minutes. So
that'll be great. Thanks, Cree. And then please reach out to me by email if we don't get to anything now. Thank you so much, everyone. Great to have you here today. Okay, Amanda, I saw your question. Can you link to something? Yes, and so that's what we do. Once we convert a PDF file to a Canvas page, we just replace the link that would usually go to the PDF file with the link that goes to the Canvas page. And so the students click on it just the same, but instead of having a PDF open up or download, they stay right there in Canvas with your Canvas navigation. They see that course content right there. And I can look at that I can show you specific examples if you're interested for your course, but you can see your content just right there as a Canvas page. They can still download the PDF if they want to. Thank you so much. Okay. Thanks again, everybody, for your time today.